All right, Reign of Messiah, part five, the last great day. So who's been here for all four parts so far? I plan to do this in four parts. We're on to part five. I'm not sure if we're going to get through part five today. We're going to try and move through this as fast as we can. For those who haven't been a part of the series to date and looking at these sort of things, I just encourage you maybe to go to the website and have a listen, because in context of some of the stuff we're talking about today, it's important, some of the groundwork and understanding how this has been laid. But what we really did in part one was we looked at the seven kahal, or the ecclesia, which is the lampstands mentioned in the book of Revelation, in part one and in part two. And so we went right through all of that, the report card essentially of us and how our Messiah views us. And this is important because in the beginning of the book of Revelation, you know, the revelation of Yeshua, it's important that we understand how he sees us. You know, again, a lot of times we've got the menorah up here, and this is seen purely as a Jewish symbol. But it's not a Jewish symbol. It is actually a symbol of the ecclesia, the church. And so because it's only been preserved or even used, I guess, in a modern sense, in a modern Judeo sense, we've gotten used to associating symbolism to something that is actually a biblical symbol that's pointing to you, and it's not about it being anything to do essentially with a modern Judeo practice. So again, as we learn these things and we revisit the word and start to understand it and let the Ruach start to teach us, and we get in and we read the words ourselves, we start operating again as a body, we can start to see that, hey, maybe both sides of this riverbank hasn't perhaps shown us, a biblically or a sound biblical position, especially when it comes to things of looking at who and what is the church. And of course, we've gone through many teachings and looked at various aspects of what it means when Scripture is referring to Israel. And so if you don't know who Israel is, you won't have a clue what this subject of the millennial reign is. So if Israel is a modern state and a piece of dirt for you in your mind and in your heart, much of Scripture is not going to make sense to you. But if you start to get a biblical definition of what Israel is and who Israel is, you'll start to realize this is his people. And all of a sudden, all of Scripture matters and none of it is third person anymore. And so that's important, because to address this subject in particular is very difficult, because we're talking about the future plan of who? Yeshua. Yeah, this is the final age, the final stage of our Messiah, our King, our groom. And if we don't understand what he's got planned, he's choosing a bride to walk with him in this final stage, to governance and to serve with them. Well, if we don't understand what that is, what we're being called to, or if we're not even interested that we've got this extra age, how interested or good of a bride are we? We're betrothed into something, and he's got a plan, a final age. So the end of this age is upon us. We don't know how long we have to go, but we know it's coming. And it's very possible that all of us are going to see the end of this age. Not the end of the world and all this doomsday garbage and, you know, a lot of the false prophecy and teaching and fear-based mongering that goes on in the body of Messiah. Now, that doesn't mean that things are not going to be difficult in the close of this age. But our focus is not anti-Messiah, and we're going to try and put that to rest, especially at our extreme Shabbat. But our focus is the Messiah. And so if we are a bride, we're going to be interested in who he actually is and what he's planning, not what I think, right? So is anybody want to, we all have a choice in here, right? We can keep our image of what it's all about and our view, or we can go to the word and continue to go, what does he say the next plan or stage is all about? Which one do you want? Yeah. If we don't, there's no point going into the word. There's no point walking together. There's no point receiving from a body if we don't really care. I like my imagination of him and who he is and who I and what I think it is he's doing. Or I actually want to know. And so as a fellowship, we've been marching through this Reign of Messiah. And is anybody starting to realize this thing's a little bit different than what you may have imagined today? One thing I do know for sure, though, when I'm willing to get in and look at what his view on matters are, inevitably they're always better than mine. Than what my imagination could come up with, or what I thought, or whatever my religious journey or past had taught me. Now, Like everything, Yeshua urged us to build our house upon the rock, right? And he is the rock, not the sand. We know that the sand, you know, this picture of rock and sand, we know that sand is made of rock. And there's lots of truth in the sand. But that truth is not cohesive. And that truth can often lead us to being in a very shifting place, because when the trials and the fires of our life, which we're going to talk about a little bit today, hit, all of a sudden our faith can get shaken. And if we're built on sand, although there's a lot of truth in all those little bits of rock, if it is not forming a cohesive picture of who our Messiah is and what our faith is, we're going to find ourselves in trouble. Has anybody ever known that when trouble hits, somebody has lost their faith or becomes confusing or wonders what God is doing and all that sort of thing? And how about even in your own life? This is why it doesn't mean just because we build on the sand that there's not truth in that. It's a bunch of little rocks. But that wasn't what we were supposed to build on. Does anybody know we just had a couple of earthquakes here? Some serious ones and a really good shake. Would you rather have your foundations of your house drilled into rock during those shakes, or would you have liked to have been built on sand? You know, when I was down in Christchurch in 2011, when a lesser scale earthquake actually hit, though, closer to the city, and saw the damage that was done to those houses that were built in sand areas, essentially experienced liquefaction. And literally the land beneath them started to collapse. Guess what happened to the houses? They didn't look very pretty, I can tell you. If we don't build on his truth, on his word, if we build on our denominations, our religions, our imaginations, my view, I, if we don't do that, I promise you, whether it's your fire and testing to date or what is coming, it is going to take the very depths of your faith and is going to test it to its absolute limit. Be built on the rock as we experience that and as we walk forth. So this is what we're trying to do here. All of us have come through our various journeys, but we're not meeting on the Sabbath so we can be a part of some weird religious thing. We're actually trying to honor and understand his ways and his truth and his life. There's lots of people out there. If you want cults, if you want various religions, denominations, whatever it is, then go have it. There's plenty of it. There's a smorgasbord. But for us that are in here, we're looking at a subject that our eyes need to be open to if we're going to truly start to have a perspective of a bride as he sees it, not as we see it. Because right now, most of the teachings out there about the bride are all about who? The bride. The real teachings of understanding the bride and Messiah and understanding his next stage are about who? The groom. But it's all about our inheritance. It's all about me. It's all about what, you know, and we get into this place. We're naturally born into a place of self. Okay, and then we looked at, so we started getting to look at the thousand-year reign, and then we started to go through, and this is where we're kind of sitting. What can we expect and know according to, or what is given to us in the Word? So what glimpses are we given to there? So that's really what we're going to start to look at. These were some of the scriptures that I'd given very early in the piece at the beginning of the series. Has anybody started to do some looking at these? I have no way of proving that. So you all say yes. Yeah. Okay. Actually, with this group, I believe you would. You actually would. I love the way everybody holds everybody to account here. It's so refreshing to actually see that, you know. And so that's what we want to do, right? Whether it be me, whether it be you, whatever it is. Nobody is without account. So who's going to hold each other to account? Board meetings over a such and such denomination, or those of us in the body walking together and following our Messiah, as led by the Holy Spirit and the Ruach? We are the ones that must grow and mature and start to do this. Not just whatever, the people that yabber up at the front. Okay, so we looked at the Messiah will literally reign for 1,000 years. We have the start of his bride and the remnant of Israel following the fulfillment of the appointed times, the Moedim. So that's very interesting. Again, you're all starting to learn that. But if you know how prophetic that is, if you know those, then you're going to start to be able to view a subject called the millennial reign. We will reign with Messiah as kings and priests. And we know that there's heavenly house that we've been promised. What's this all about if we're ruling and reigning with Messiah? So we looked into that. And that starts to lead into this whole thing about resurrection bodies and what we're all heading to. Did anybody find that sort of kind of interesting? We start to look at Jacob's ladder, how the angels appeared, indeed how Yeshua in the very end appeared with the disciples and literally showed him things that were of an interdimensional quality. These are real realities in Scripture. I didn't put them there. I didn't write them. I didn't show them. Yeshua has chosen to reveal certain aspects and components for us to understand things. There's a reason. Does everybody agree that Yah puts in the Word things for a reason? Right? So if we stick to the Word, then we can have Word-based discussions. Right? And then we might start trying to do, you know, things His way. But if we don't stick to the Word and we go into our imaginations, it's called Talmud. All right, the teaching, the practices of man. Now, there are certain things that even in this subject matter that we will conjecture beyond a certain point of the word trying to understand. But at least let us admit when we're conjecturing, right? The word's never conjecturing. My understanding of it can enter into conjecture. We get that? And so this is where we all have to be in that place together and work through as a body, because if we learn to do this as a body, He will lead us to understand truths on all matters, including this one, which I love with being the millennial reign, as you all know. The law and His word will go forth from Jerusalem, right? So we looked at that on this journey. Again, just not to labor this one too much, but it's interesting. In Hebrew thinking versus Greek thinking is what? Replacing stuff, right? You have the old and you have the new, right? And it's all this, you know, out with the old and in with the new. Hebrew thinking exclusively is building one upon the other. So think of it again as building your house. Just because you're building the walls doesn't mean you've thrown away the foundations. Okay? Yet spiritually, in a Western sense, in our Greek sense, we've been taught to do this. Now, it's not scriptural and it's not biblical, as many of you are finding out, but we've been literally taught to do this. Throw away your foundations, because we got the walls now. Here's what's interesting. If we're to take scripture seriously on this one, okay, we're led to believe that somehow we threw out the foundation, but when Yeshua comes back, He's going to go and put it back in. And somehow the walls remain standing in the meantime. Does that make sense to anyone? Yet that's what the word is saying. So we have to contend with this. We have to understand this in its proper context. Seven steps of looking at something in context. Because if we don't get this, we have a king that's returning, a groom, a plan, who's actually going to have Torah and the law go forth from Jerusalem. And He's going to have kings and priests, which He's selecting, to ensure this governance is going on across the world. Does it make sense that we temporarily removed it, and the very ones that are going to be chosen to be kings and priests in that weren't even exposed to it and didn't even have a clue what it was? None of you in your walks, in your life, in your jobs, if you're hiring, if you had people work for you, you want to get a job done, none of you would accept that kind of behavior. I'm going to choose somebody for the job that hasn't got a clue what it is that they need to do. It's illogical. But because we don't take the whole counsel, the whole word, we allow all these little bits and pieces and cults, religions, denominations, sects, whatever they are, to start twisting the scriptures and perverting them. And indeed, the apostles warned of this. The disciples warned of this, that there would be unstable people that would come in not understanding the scriptures and twist them to itch your ears. And guess what it says? Who wanted their ears itched? We did. In the end, we'll pay to have those people stand up here and itch your ears. Isn't that fascinating? You see, these people that are doing this in the body of Messiah, these people that are doing this in Christianity or the Hebrew roots messianic side, the people that are doing this are judgment. Yah could get rid of them at any time. So if you're worried about your false prophets and apostles standing behind there, and, oh, if we just got rid of this guy or this person or this woman, whatever, then we'd be good. Really? There's always going to be somebody to replace them, because there's people that are going and entertained by this that are going to demand somebody to take their place. So our battle is not against flesh and blood. It is against principalities and spirits in high places. We need to understand what the Bible means by that, not our own little imaginations. So, and then we talked about this future millennial temple, which to great degrees, the last eight chapters of Ezekiel is devoted to this in exceptional detail. This is not allegory, okay? If you want to try and make this allegory, I'll be able to take anything you want concerning a description of anything historically, archaeologically, architecturally in Scripture and get rid of it. Because there is more information on a temple that is going to be built and more measurement and exact detail than there was on Noah's Ark. So we don't get a chance to play with this. There is great lengths, but there is something that was missing in it. Everybody remember what was missing?
Gold.
So the major feature of the temple that was built under Solomon, indeed even inside the tabernacle, concerning the actual Ark of the Covenant itself and the implements that went in with the Holy of Holies and the Holies, all feature this incredible thing called gold. Yet it's missing in the temple that Yeshua is coming back to reign and rule from with his bride. This major feature. And in fact, there's evidence that Solomon sent out, you know, in, as Mark had shared with us, that he had sent out people right across the whole spectrum of what we call the known, you know, what would have been the known world at that time, and the world that supposedly hadn't been discovered, to get precious metals, and that was gold. One of them was gold. So they went to great lengths, according to Yah's instructions at that time, to put it there, yet it's just missing now. So I would say that there's something there for us to discover and find. We're going to move on for that, but this is going to be the question by the time we're done this series that we're going to try and answer. Where has the gold gone? People will still be able to die 100 years old when they're considered young. So the wages of sin is death, yeah. So there's people that are going to still die, according to Scripture, in the millennial reign. So this isn't just a fun little picnic and everybody's sitting around, right? So, again, how so? What's this? What's this all about? I thought the next age was just a big party. Entry does appear to be slowed down. And we talked about this, that the actual presence of Messiah himself, I believe, is going to change the name of the game. The actual creator of life, this incredible thing of Yeshua's presence, may actually have a physical, scientific effect on the effect of entropy, which we all expose. So the longer life, the tree of life being with us, it starts to come back into play. And again, I'm conjecturing here now, but I see longer lives coming back with Yeshua's presence. So my conjecture is at least based on some biblical connection. Then we got to, and this is where we finished up last time, we're going to pick up here. There will still be animal sacrifices in the new temple. Yeshua's here, and there's animal sacrifices going on. Anybody find that strange? Like, what? One of the reasons why you're going to find that strange is that traditionally, as Christianity has taught it, we tend to think, well, that's been thrown away, so animal sacrifice was thrown away. But there's a huge thing you're going to see in this little section that I'm going to remind you of that had to be that the disciples themselves were reminding the religious people of the time of. Okay? And so we need that same reminder. Sin will still be present in the earth in that population. We're going to look at not everything is a paradise under Messiah. Lucifer will be locked away during this time. Interesting. I say Lucifer, but better to say the office of Hasatan or the adversary. Complacency and the disease of iniquity, lawlessness, and the missing the mark that it breeds is very real during this time, yet Yeshua is here on earth. Now, these are a lot of interesting statements. Predators will lie down together with the non-predators. Nations will still be monitored and judged. 1,000 years, okay, this renewed heavens and new earth, you know, will come or are coming into existence. What does that mean? And we are not given our marriage for eternity. Remember Yeshua was correcting the disciples, the Sanhedrin, the Pharisees? You know, you do err not knowing your scriptures, right? Very offensive. Right, because these people knew their scriptures. So he's saying to them, you do err, not knowing your scriptures. Why? Because we are not married nor given in marriage in the age to come. With who? Each other. So what's going on? This whole Bible context is a marriage covenant, yet we are experiencing a shadow picture right now in our own marriages and walks. Okay. I've got here sort of hiding in the background Hebrews 10 states, okay? There will be animal sacrifice at this time. What? Yet in Hebrews 10:4 states, for it is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats should take away sins. A few verses later we read, and every priest stands daily ministering and offering at times the same sacrifices which can never take away sins. So that's Hebrews 10:4. So what's going on here? Well, this why that I've got here in the middle is what has been missed by the majority of the believing body. Because if you understand that every animal sacrificed before Yeshua, not one of them ever took away sin. So any sacrifices with Yeshua coming back and being here in the temple, are those sacrifices going to be the thing that actually takes away sin? You see, we need to understand what these shadow pictures were for. What was the sacrifice all about? Because if it never took away sin, I assure you, it's not going to take away sin when he's here and ruling. Do you see what's going on? So all of you can now go, oh, that's right. Okay. All right, so there's nothing weird going on here. The blood of Yeshua will and can ever be replaced by anything. Not your blood, not animal's blood, not anyone's blood. Yet he is still going to have animal sacrifice. You say, oh, well, really, Curtis, is that going to be the case? And the chambers and the entries thereof. Okay, so we're looking in Ezekiel, and we're actually talking about this millennial temple, this temple that's going to be built. But it's interesting. It's being set up close to the gates where they washed the burnt offerings. So now taking these things, and in the porch of the gate, to the table set aside, and the tables on that set aside to slay thereon the burnt offering. So anybody who thinks this is not a living offering, I've heard that kind of garbage being taught. Oh, well, yeah, it's not animals anymore. No, it is. According to the word. It doesn't matter what I think. There's going to be the slaying of animals coming. Now that's fascinating. What's happening here? Because we've got a group of people right now on the earth trying to get this third temple built, and we got to get animal sacrifices going and get this whole modern Judeo thing going, and I'm telling you, all of that's an abomination. They may be trying to implement a counterfeit before the real thing comes back and the reason for the real thing. And I'd suggest to you that that counterfeit is well and truly in play right now. There are people right now on the earth wanting to build another temple in Jerusalem. And they're going to find any excuse or whatever it is they can do to build this thing and to put it up. And as soon as that's put up, guess what's going to happen? Because they've already got in place right now a Sanhedrin that's been appointed in Israel. This modern state of Israel right now. What do you think they're going to do as soon as the temple's built? Yeah. So we got a problem here. Either this is something Yeshua wants or it isn't. And if it isn't, we better understand what this monkey business is all about. That doesn't negate, and we shouldn't throw out the baby with the bathwater, that there is something coming that does. So the enemy, the adversary, is always trying to counterfeit and to pervert something. That perversion is well and truly in play right now on the earth as we speak. And many Christians are falling for it. And so are Messianic and the Hebrew root side. So both sides of the riverbank are falling for this stuff. When's the millennial temple going to be built according to the scriptures we looked at so far? Who's the one who's actually overseeing it? Christ. Yeshua. I suggest to you anything built in Jerusalem in the modern state of Israel right now, do you think Yeshua is going to be standing over and building, you know, watching this thing be built, make sure it's built right? So what are they building? Scripture tells us that the temple right is here. It will never leave here. But the shadow pictures is important for something. Now, Yeshua seems to be carrying on a shadow picture heading into the millennial reign. Don't you think that would be interesting why he would see the need to do that? He's actually seeing the need to continue the shadow picture. Fascinating, yeah. Because there's a tutor that's still in play. Do you know it says that until what? Not one yacht or tittle will pass away from the Torah until heaven and earth pass away. That hasn't happened yet, has it? Oh, do you mean he's serious about that literally? Even to the end of his reign? It's exactly what Scripture is saying. Isaiah 56:7. Even them I will bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices be accepted upon my altar, and for my house shall be called a house of prayer for all people. By the way, that's future tense. If you know what you're reading there in Isaiah, beforehand and afterhand, it has not been called a house of prayer for all people yet. Yet this is exactly what's going to be happening. Just in case you, when Zechariah chimes in. These major prophets and minor prophets, they're literally pointing to something that they've been given. This incredible time, this plan of their Messiah. And every pot in Jerusalem and Judah shall be holy to Elohim of hosts, so that all who sacrifice may come and take of them and boil the meat of the sacrifice in them. And there shall no longer be a traitor in the house of Elohim of the host on that day. Again, future tense. Does anybody realize your scripture is telling you there's sacrifices coming in the days to come? Go and do your homework before and after this. I didn't write this. I didn't make this. You know what he's asking me to do? When I was first reading this, when he was leading me to these scriptures all those years ago, do you know what he was saying to Curtis? Curtis, your imagination, your understanding, or whatever your viewpoint is today, that's nice. That's nice. But are you interested in what I'm actually planning and why? Not whatever you thought to date and then trying to disagree with it. Ignore those scriptures and keep on preaching your Talmud. Has anybody found that you've been looking at some scriptures over the last few years in your walk and it didn't quite agree with previous years of how you saw those scriptures, even if you saw those scriptures before in your walk? Has anybody come across some scriptures that you've received some approving and discipline by? I know I have. Do you know that's a good thing? That's a good thing to be corrected and reproved. But as spiritual children, do children like correction and reproof? No. So we got to find an environment we can walk together and receive this in a healthy manner so we don't just get into quarrels and acting silly on things. I'm more interested in what he's saying is actually going to happen, and then let us walk together to figure out and understand these things. Again, here's me laboring the point with Hebrews 10:4. So let's just be conscious whenever you're speaking to somebody, it never took away before, it's not going to take away after, but the shadow picture's in play until the end of the millennial age. And there's a reason for that. Okay. Okay, Lucifer will be locked up, or the adversary will be locked up and sealed during this time. Has anybody ever heard the statement, the devil made me do it? The devil made me do it. It wasn't me, it was the devil. Right? We are wonderful, aren't we, at not taking accountability for our behavior. Does anybody agree with that? Right? If I can blame the devil for my actions, right? Or say collectively we can blame the devil, right? We can blame the adversary for everything. Then who's off the hook? Yeah. I'd suggest to you that everything I read in Scripture is about a fire, a refining, me looking at the reflection of myself, being purified, entering into a sanctification process, having to look in the mirror and go, what? Maybe it's the state I'm in that is entertaining and generating a lot of shenanigans. It's here. And unless this is cleaned up, unless this is circumcised, unless the leaven, the little bit of leaven that can leaven a whole lump, gets out, because that leaven is hypocrisy. I look back on much of my walk over the decades and I see great hypocrisy. And I'm sure Yeshua, a holy, set apart Elohim, still looks at us and sees our hypocrisy when we can't. But I don't know about you, but in a few years from now, would you like to have more or less hypocrisy in your life? Yeah. You see, we want to get there, right? But it's a state that we're in. Do you remember Adam and Eve? Right? What was the first thing? You know, he's being had up, right? Adam's being had up for this scenario that's gone down in the garden. And do you remember what came out of his mouth when Yah's questioned him? Okay? Literally. Yeah. The woman made me do it, right? So we get to blame the woman at this stage, right? But it was worse than that. Okay? The woman you gave me. He wasn't just blaming her. He was blaming the Creator. Now, this happens all the time. I know we're not willing, you know, sometimes to admit this, but literally, this is Adam's state now, that he's fallen. Now, I believe a very beautiful thing, and that's a very mistaught thing happened before that. But when he literally became infected, the excuses started to flow. And he was not going to stop at the woman he loved, nor his Creator himself. And I've seen people blame God or the people they love constantly when things go wrong. I only have to go to a mirror to find that person. hopefully I'm doing that less in my walk, in my life. I'm trying to submit and to humble and to be, have a heart circumcision. But we don't want to be these people. Do you know what? I suggest we stop making the adversary an Elohim, a God. He's not on the throne. There is no boxing match. Stop giving him credit for everything. He's got a job to do, and he's doing it. He is an adversary. He's allowed to be in an adversarial position by Elohim, by our Elohim. The question isn't whether that's true or not. The question is, why does Yah allow it? Because there's going to come a time when it's no more. Now, in this millennial reign, this millennial age, do you know what he does? He takes the office of Hasatan and locks it up, according to Scripture. And he sees the dragon, the ancient serpent, who is the devil or the adversary, and Hasatan, and bound him for how long? 1,000 years. This is in the book of Revelation. So during this time, after this wedding feast, and now we've got this incredible millennial age that has some special purpose, he's locking away the adversary. Guess what happens to the excuses of those people during those 1,000 years when it comes to the devil? It's not there. And in fact, I can suggest to you that a few generations of being people being born into the millennial reign, guess what the devil's going to become to them? A myth. And they're going to be believers. See, the devil's a myth to who right now? Non-believers. Guess who the devil's going to become a myth to in those 1,000 years? Believers. So you imagine if you're serving, if we have the honor to serve as kings and priests, the governance, the bride of Messiah, and we are literally in a place where you're working now with people that still have sin, that can still die, that are now used to who sitting on the throne? Yeshua. You see, we think of it, imagine King Yeshua sitting on the throne right now. Wouldn't that be awesome? We'd be like our whole lives, right? It just would be incredible. But if you were born into that, King Yeshua is what? Normal. The bride of Messiah is normal. This is their reality. Yet they still have what's in them? Lawlessness. And they are still missing the mark as a result. Now we're going to start to get back to think of why there would still need to be a tutor in play. Why we don't want to throw this out. Because do you believe, I'm going to suggest to you, that it is very possible if we read certain scriptures and a judgment and a great white throne judgment that is coming at the end of all of this, that it might be possible for somebody to not choose their salvation during the millennial reign. And I'm going to propose even another stronger question to you as you think about this. I believe that's not only possible, but I believe it may be harder for them to receive a message in a better environment. In an environment where Yeshua is normal. And the bride of Messiah. In fact, and there is no adversary. There was refiner's fire. A more of a perfect government. No war. None of these earthquakes. Do you think about this? The better the environment gets, is it easier or harder to bring someone to a place of truth? How many atheists do you find when a plane's going down? On the plane. Not a lot. I can tell you, I've been in the earthquakes watching so-called, you know, these people, oh, I'm agnostic, or I'm atheist, blah, 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 and they all have their philosophical arguments and discussions during the week at work. I saw a whole group of these people freaking out when that building was starting to shake. Some of them brought to their knees in prayer, scared so bad. See, it's really easy to be tough spiritually, isn't it, when everything's going cool? I'd suggest to you, is there going to be a need for kings and priests in the time to come? That's why he's got them. It's possible we can be looking at the raising of the eternal family. And he's chosen a bride to do this. And we're preaching something today that says the very thing she's going to need to understand as a foundation, the very thing that she's going to need to impart, according to the word, not to Curtis Reed, has been done away with. Does that make sense to anyone? It didn't to me. When I started to become honest and start reading these scriptures and going, wait a minute, pastor, wait a minute, rabbi, wait a minute, preacher, wait a minute, religion, wait a minute, all of this stuff. Why are you not preaching, teaching, and sharing this scripture with the people so that we can contend and ask the questions. Not so we can be right. Is anybody here sick of trying to argue that you're right? How about we get into the business of actually repenting and helping each other get to know and seek right? I can't be right about all things and all matters. You know, remember we talked about this in this series, didn't we? Who here thinks they're going to impress Yeshua when they stand in front of him on Judgment Day? Does anybody in this room think you're going to hear, "My goodness, that's impressive how much you know"? It's silliness. What have we done? We're entertaining all this Talmud of man. Well, to a certain degree, we have to have some Talmud. Not all Talmud is untruth, by the way. But we do want to understand that if Mark's giving his impression or interpretation of something, or Louis or Russell or whoever it is, what we want to know is this. Does it line with his word at least? At least I have something to contend with then in the process. Make sense? But if I have to hold everybody to some standard, because if I'm telling everybody that they're wrong, right, and I'm right, right, who's become the holder of all knowledge? Me. This becomes and turns into a Nicolaitan environment where we will actually hoard this over the people. That's not right. He's told us to play a body game, a team game, and to learn and to grow up so we don't get caught up to this. You know the kind of people that get caught up in weird cults and religions? You know, seriously? They do. Why do you think they start following after this? Because they really know their word and they've really matured in Messiah, or because they haven't? Because I'll tell you, some of the weirdness that's going on that level is because they are taking advantage of ignorance. It's the only reason why you'll entertain this stuff. But when we grow and mature, you're going to stop entertaining the latest schmo that comes along and says, "Oh, I'm an apostle. I'm a prophet. I'm a this, I'm a that," right? Well, the more mature you get, are you going to fall for the guy pulling a rabbit out of the hat? The kids all love that. Spiritually, we love that when these guys can pull rabbits out of the hat. But when you start to grow up, that's not so impressive. You're going, "What's under that table? Let me see that hat." Right? This is what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to mature and grow so that we can do this. Now, this is interesting. He is going to put an environment in play that says, "You know what? I'm going to show you the state and the reality of lawlessness. I'm going to be ruling." Do anybody think that Yeshua is going to have a darn good ruling governance those 1,000 years? Would you say he's going to do a pretty good job? Yeah, I would think so. And now we've got no adversary in the picture. So is our excuse going to be what now? We've lost, the devil made me do it, so now what do we got left? Oh, it's the White House, it's the Beehive, it's their fault, it's Rome's. Is there any Rome, according to Scripture, anywhere in the millennial reign? No. Who is the only thing left to be the excuse? Us. I think we're going to go through, and what the people are going to go through, and what we're going to help be a part of if we're honored to serve, is we're going to see people go through an incredible refining process. But that refining process is going to be even tougher than the one you've experienced. And he's bringing someone to help in this process because it's required. Reading here from Revelations 23. "So, and he threw him into the pit and shut him up and sealed it over him, that he might not deceive the nations any longer, until the what? The 1,000 years ended. After that, he must be released for a little while." What? So at the end of this, he's still going to release the adversary again. What's going on? Has the adversary been used by Yah this whole time? Is it possible he might use him at the end of this time, especially if people are living real long, to test their hearts? Do you know that Scripture tells us the numbers that will rebel against Yeshua on the throne himself and a ruling governance of his bride? No question who, you know, no more I believe in God or don't. No one's going to be going, "Oh, I don't believe in an Elohim." That doesn't exist in this time. Do you know the numbers that rebel are considered as the sands of the sea? What do you think the population of the earth is going to be at this time? Isn't that scary? Think about this. How powerful or how influential or how degrading is the essence of lawlessness inside us? What does this thing really do to us? And when the 1,000 years is expired, Hasatan, the adversary, shall be loosed out of his prison. And he shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, and gather them together to battle, the number of whom is as the sands of the sea. I didn't write that. Fascinating, isn't it? There is a major rebellion against the king going down on earth at the end of this. Does anybody find that interesting? The animal kingdom will live together in harmony. We've all heard about the wolf and the lamb and the lion and the lamb and the leaf straw. So there's a thing here that's being given to us in Isaiah that's describing this future time. Is that happening now? What happens when predators lie down with non-predators at the moment? One doesn't get up. Which one do you think gets up? I'd say the predator does. You see, we don't know a world that doesn't have to, that doesn't shed blood on its own accord. Okay? And we're going to see this actually coming with people. I'm going to suggest to you, as we keep going into think back why I started off with animal sacrifice, if we're honest with Scripture, it appears that it may be possible the only way certain people may see any form of death is when they see a sacrifice. And do you know people will be coming up year to year to see and to visit King Yeshua? Now, I'm going to tell you something. If anybody, you might want to try this, whose children's here has seen an animal being slaughtered live? Okay, so we got some hands down the back there. So, okay. I'm not trying to say slaughtering animals. I'm just saying that it's an interesting thing, okay, when they've seen that. Okay? But if you've never seen it, if you remember the first time it ever occurred, for those people who haven't, for those kids that haven't, but maybe yourself, who here has seen an animal slaughtered live in front of you? Do you remember the first time you saw that? How'd you feel? Well, in fact, it's shocking. Now imagine if you had to raise a little lamb. This beautiful little thing. Has anybody here had a lamb? Yeah? Yeah. Right, yeah. This animal. I believe something went down in the garden that was more painful than we can ever possibly imagine, because we write off kind of like the need that why an animal had to die because of what had happened with mankind at that time. But what I would say is this. I believe it was a terrible thing for Adam and Eve to have gone through when that animal was slaughtered by Yah because of what they'd done. I think there's something much deeper there than we can ever know. But I will tell you this much. They learned their lesson then, and there's a lesson that's going to be learned in the last stage of this. Because if you've never known a world of war, and the predators are lying down with the non-predators, and you've got this rule, and things are going on, and everything's kind of normal, and somebody marches you up, and you're young, and it's the first time you're in the temple, you're visiting King Yeshua, and they go, oh, look, mommy, daddy, there's a lamb. Bah. It's coming up, and it's all beautiful, and this little lamb with his furry little nose, and furry little face, and the little pink nose, and he's there, and the ears are like this, and they come up, and all of a sudden, one of the high priests comes out, whoosh, and blood is going everywhere. What do you think happens to that first time you've ever seen that? See, we watch violence on television, on our computers, on our screens, on YouTube, whatever, right? We've grown up with violence. Do you know how desensitized you are? What happens if you have no desensitizing going on? You are literally going, is that what blood looks like? Is it possible that this may become a stronger and greater tutor than even it could be today? And there's a need for it to be playing its final rollout, this amazing thing of Torah, even to the point of animal sacrifice, to literally take people into that place. The king that is in front of you, that you are about to meet, that you're about to see, by the way, as he is, they rip the beard off his face. A marred spectacle. Everybody else gets to enjoy this. You know that? But he doesn't. He has chosen to remain, to be seen as he is. In fact, he was so unrecognizable with the disciples after he raised, even in his resurrected body, what do we know? They didn't even recognize him. Furthermore, Who could put their finger in his side and in his hands when he came in and showed his instrumental qualities at that time? But they weren't, even then, they were, you know, free. Who's done this? They're trying to figure out, why was he not recognizable? We're not prepared for this. We're going to talk about this in our Extreme Shabbat, no tacky, a bit more, of how serious this can go. I'd suggest to you that a world where people are experiencing that is going to get a shock when it is confronted with death. Now that understanding, mommy, daddy, why did the lamb have to die? Let me tell you about my king. Let me take you to meet him. Because you know what happened to that little lamb? Little Bobby, Joey, millennial Bobby and Joey. Jill. Anne. Whatever we want to call. Whatever anybody's names are going to be, right? Let me tell you that he did that for us. Do you think this is going to have meaning at this time? You mean that's what they did to... Oh no, it was worse than that. Let us share with you what was actually done to our Messiah. Because what that lamb went through is not anywhere close. But more importantly, let me share with you, father, son, daughter, the why, not the what. Why he actually did this. I'd suggest to you that if we're willing to take the scripture literally in context and understand when and where it's speaking allegory, where it's giving analogies, that we understand that those analogies and allegory are always pointing to a literal thing. And we must view all of scripture in this manner. That's why the seven steps of context are important. Whenever we're contending with it, again, just further in Isaiah 11, 6, 7. Men will no longer learn war. Look at these guys. You know, we've never known life without war, right? That's all we've known. Just war and bloodshed, and we just keep doing it and doing it and doing it. Why? Why do we have to kill people? Can we really come up with a reasonable reason for this? Because everything about us is temporary, right? So even if I kill somebody for what they have, guess what I get to lose? Whatever it was I killed them for, I'm going to lose. You see, if we don't understand the reality of our mortality, we can't even justify. How do we justify taking and murdering somebody for self-gain? You're going to die. You don't get to keep anything. You've come in with nothing, you're going out with nothing. So what's this all about? And he shall judge among the nations. So reading from Minor Prophets in the Tanakh, Micah 4:3. And he shall judge among many people and rebuke strong nations. So we're going to have strong nations during this time. What? Afar off. And they shall beat their swords into plowshares. And they shall and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up a sword against nation. Neither shall they learn war anymore. Has that happened? That's the state during his reign. Do you think we're going to be helping these people maybe not fall into war? In fact, it says, don't you know you will judge the 12 tribes of Israel? Remember we were looking at that? You mean we're going to be judging? You're going to be in a place of passing sentence? I'm not talking about a flippant thought about something. There is a ruling governance that actually is going to have the authority of the throne to pass sentence on the behavior of nations. Who in here thinks they're ready to be doing that? That's pretty serious. His appointed times will still be honored during this time. Again, let's think about the rock and the house and the sand. Now, we've been told, oh, no, that's been done away with. So, again, we're back into that thing. Okay, we've done away with that. We've done away with that. And then it's coming back for some reason. Get rid of the foundations, right? Let's hope the walls stand, and then we'll get the foundation back in there. It's silliness. This is a future time. Okay, Zechariah 14, 16 to 17. And it shall come to pass, everyone that is left of all nations which came against Jerusalem shall even go up from year to year to worship the king. Is that happening? No. Again, read the scriptures before and after this, but you're going to clearly find out this is a future tense. Shall even go from year to year to worship the king, and the Elohim of hosts will keep the Feast of Tabernacles or Sukkot. What? You mean the appointed times, which were supposed to be celebrated and honored throughout our generations, he's still into it. And it shall be that who will not come up, the families of the earth, Jerusalem, shall worship the king, the Elohim of hosts, even upon them shall be no rain. So there's now even a judgment being cast upon them for not doing this one. Now that's fascinating to me. I particularly think with Sukkot, because this represents, and it will be from an honoring perspective, it's going to be now in a place of remembrance, as we also now are in a place of remembering Pasuk, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, right? Shavuot, Pentecost. This is now going to be fulfilled. So this is now what? A remembrance. Well, if it's a wedding feast, I'd suggest to you this has become a remembrance of an anniversary. Whose anniversary? Yeshua's. Do you know what is interesting? He only particularly links, that I can find in Scripture anyway, a consequence or a judgment against Sukkot, okay? Not against not honoring the other ones during this time, because we know that the world is going to experience lawlessness as he rules. This one's fascinating, because if this is truly linking back to remembering of an anniversary of a wedding that literally was fulfilled with his bride, you have a groom, I believe, saying, you know what? You can disgrace me. You're not going to disgrace her. This is the seriousness of a groom that does look after his bride, that does watch over her, that does protect her. And I think you're getting a glimpse into that. Because I can't find out why particularly he signals this one out. But we do know, not only is it being honored, but there's judgment coming upon not honoring it. So who thinks this has been done away with? Again, I just throw the Shema in here just to remind everybody, this is how Yeshua answered. And thou shalt, what? Love your Elohim with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first or greatest commandment. He was reading and quoting Deuteronomy 6. This is what it's all about. We need to figure out. So let me read this. You shall love your Elohim the way you want with your heart, right? When you want to with your soul. How you view him in your own mind, and particularly what it is, whatever it is you want to do. See, who defines what all of that means? We or him? So he's got a view of what that means to love him with all his heart. It's actually sitting in something we call the Bible. Maybe those who are interested in being a bride are going to be interested in knowing what does the groom define him being loved? Do you remember anybody when Yeshua was asked? Right? If you love me, keep my, my Torah. What a response. Okay, this is in the New Testament, recorded in the New Testament, the Brit Hadashah, and he's answering that way because he's going to create a bunch of confusion for us 2,000 years later. Who's the author of confusion? Yeah, the adversary. So do you think Yeshua was bringing confusion into this matter, or do you think something's come in that has created confusion in this matter? Because I'd suggest to you, if you're honestly willing just to read that for what it is, it's very clear. And it's coming from Yeshua himself. If you love me, honor my Torah. If you love me, not if you saved, or this or that, or all this other conjecture comes into it. The specific statement was, if you love me, I believe is a statement of a bride and a groom. For this is the covenant, right, that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declare that I will put my law with them and write it on their hearts. And I shall be their Elohim, and they shall be my people. We all know this has not happened, and he's just defined what the covenant is. And we've now just read that there is future from the other prophets saying, what's going to go forth from Jerusalem? His Torah, his ways, his truth, his life. And he is literally saying, though, it is not obedience for obedience' sake. Obedience is not on the stand here. He's going to get his obedience. What's on the stand here is that I want this to be real. That you may obey me out of love. There's something set aside for a bridal or a covenant picture here. Again, this is being quoted in Hebrew. So, this is the covenant that I will make with them in those days, declares Yah. I will put their laws on their hearts and I'll write them on their minds. So, why is he quoting something that's been done away with? This is in your New Testament or your Brit Hadashah. So, if this is being done away with, this covenant, this Torah, this thing that's supposed to be on our heart, why is this being quoted? We're going to finish up here today on this. I talk about this a lot, right, as we go through this, because if we don't have a covenant perspective, I don't believe you can understand the millennial reign. I believe a covenant perspective will start to open up all elements of your scripture. There is all these different levels of perspective. There's a childlike perspective, right? There's knowing him as a father perspective. There's knowing him as a servant. But the one that is, I believe, being poured out and made available to us in these end times, in an incredible way, is a covenant perspective, a groom bride perspective. This becomes very important. If somebody asked you what the Bible is all about, and I know I go ad nauseum at this, but now keep thinking now this in context of his plan in this millennial reign. It is all about a 6,000-year betrothal broken because of a spiritually adulterous bride. Who's the spiritually adulterous bride? Yeah. That doesn't go well with a lot of modern teaching, does it? We are the ones that have spiritually entertained things that we shouldn't have. Now, he knew that, and he knew we were going to be deceived and everything else. What he's looking for is, when it's pointed out to you, are you willing to humble? If my people humble and seek my, right, I will do what? I will heal them. Do you know that everything we're seeing going on earth, nothing's broken right now? If the believers did this, and we started to honor his ways again, the world would be witness to within one Hebrew calendar year. So 2 billion professing Christians would all of a sudden go, actually, we're going to do it your way now, Father, instead of our 30,000 plus arguments and denominations and arguing. We're going to do it your way in 1 year. All you have to know, based on those numbers, is one, right? One person only needs to know four others to be a witness to in their life. And the whole earth is witnessed the true gospel. His ways, his truth, his life. No conferences, no DVDs, no this, none of that. I think we've got an exciting time coming to us because when all this stuff goes down, you're either going to be a vessel that truly understands this truth and has it and knows in your mind, in your heart, you understand the word, you can become a vessel for something. This ends in a marriage to a repentant wife. You will read about this in the book of Revelation, the revelation of Yeshua. This was restored and sealed on a wooden cross 2,000 years ago, or stake. It doesn't matter what argument we want to make there. Don't get caught up in certain things. What was it done? Why was it done? Not the what. With the blood of the groom. The covenant with our beloved people could only be restored and made new through his death, to give a chance to allow us to make the sovereign choice, to love, obey him, and know him, or not, to allow eternity to be truly legitimate, that we may choose something in all of this. But he's going to pick a bride from it. Here's the power of hypocrisy. Judas, Peter, Timothy, you know, this shows us a very interesting thing. In this time right now, as we're speaking on earth, and I believe as we see the power of the Holy Spirit and the Ruach continue to pour out on the earth, we are going to see this, because you'll be seeing this with your own family, with your own friends, whatever it might be at this time. Some will deny at first, but will eventually look deeper and repent, turn to him and his ways. Not say sorry for all the garbage that they've had or not had in their lives, right? When you started to understand some of this stuff, you started to turn and look more at his ways. You wouldn't be here today unless that was the case. We all are allowed to go through this. Do you want to bash somebody at first when they're trying to figure this out, or they're denying, and they're going, they got all this noise screaming in their head, but I don't see it this way? What about you? Were you given the opportunity to kind of work this through when it was brought to your attention? So why do you deny somebody else the chance to vomit? Allow somebody else to go, I don't understand and I don't agree. Take your lashes and love them and make sure they get back to an inn that will take them through and allow them to go through this process. Especially if they are in a place of repentance. Allow that. Just don't bash them with whatever you think you know or your journey. Your knowledge. However, some will betray. They will not get past this point. They will keep it. And we saw this with Judas. Okay, so Peter's here, number one. Guess who was number two? He would not let go of the leaven in his house, the spiritual adultery he was a part of. He was a zealot, so was Peter. both were experiencing the same Babylonian adulterous, spiritually adulterous view of their Messiah. And they were both a part of whose? Tell me, Dean. Whose immediate discipleship were both these a part of? Yeshua's. Do you not think he knew what they were struggling with spiritually? Right? However, in the end, because Judas would not let go of his image of Messiah, as none of the Sanhedrin would and whatnot, he was used ultimately to betray Yeshua. By the way, in your close fellowship and everything else, is it possible that you're going to come across people who may look like they're in a place that they're not? And they may betray you. Let it not be. Let us not be that we can actually go, you know what? I'm not the holder of all truth. This is a righteous king, and I need to submit and to learn and to understand. But I am allowed to go through this process and supposed to be doing this in a safe environment. But ultimately, I also have the right in the end to go, no, and sell you out. Does anybody know in Scripture who's selling out who in the end times? When all of this is going to be put to the test. Somebody gives away somebody in the end times. Who is it? Unbelievers? Do you know, believers. The whole context is, do you know that it is believers that are betraying believers with anti-Messiah on earth? We're all worried about Rome, aren't we? And all these, you know, all these bad things out there. Whoa. It's not what Scripture says. Scripture says those believers that have not entered into a place of repentance are going to betray you. Don't think when Yeshua says, come follow me, that that doesn't include the fact you could experience betrayal and denial and all those sorts of things. He means it. There's a reason why he wants us to experience that. Some will hear and repent and will walk in unity with others to seek and contend for his truth. This is the space we all want to get to. Timothy got there. So this power of leaven is hypocrisy, okay? The Scripture tells us that leaven is hypocrisy. What we often are missing and not understanding is what generates hypocrisy in your life. So if you're misrepresenting your faith and you're being hypocritical in regarding to the faith, whether you know it or not, is actually spiritual adultery. How you view him and his truth is the thing that gets you to take his name in vain, to actually break the covenant. To be poor ambassadorship. Not because you're intending to. Most believers I know have good intentions, right? But it's not good intent that wins this game. It is actually the truth will set us free. And do we have truth in us? And if we have truth, the more truth I have in me, do I have more or less hypocrisy? Less. It's an exact outcome of it. The truth sets me free from this position. So we just need to keep going and just allow him to keep cleaning us up and keep being there to help each other to do so. I'm going to finish here. We're definitely heading for a part 6 on this. Sorry, everyone. So that we don't stay with this all day. But I want to give you this as a sense of hope, because this is the hope, right? Because we're dealing with a serious matter going, we never get to talk about this subject of what the groom's doing, yet we're in a very exciting time. He's doing something. But there is a point in Revelation where it's telling us that his spirit and his bride in particular, okay, not just the called, but actually the elect of the called are about to do something, because they're going to recognize who's coming. They're going to see this as a marriage covenant, and they're going to make a statement. They're going to say, come. And let the one who hears, those who ever hear what the Spirit says. Remember we started all of this in the beginning with the seven, you know, the ecclesia, the kahal? What was the instruction at the end of each one of those? Let those who have a... Okay, it finishes up this way. This is interesting. Say, come, and let the one who is thirsty come, and let the one who desires to take the water of life without price. The Spirit and the Bride are going to get to a place where there's going to be a world that is literally going to start to experience repentance. And there will be those. And it's saying, let it. Let it come. They're calling upon their groom, and by the way, they're in safe hands. We're going to let them know the truth. And we're going to love them. We're going to take our lashes. In fact, we could even be denied and betrayed to do so. Because I'll tell you, it is a powerful thing when leaven's in the house. It was so powerful in Judas. And believe me, does anybody realize that Judas was well-schooled in all of Scripture at that time? We call it the Old Testament. Do you know that? Do you think that he loved and was waiting for the coming of Messiah? Yes. He wasn't some little demon-eyed guy. He just had a concept of who he thought Messiah was. And that concept was incorrect. And it was used to deny your very Savior, Messiah, your King, your groom. Is it possible 2,000 years later, and I suggest to you again, do your homework, but do you know the same exact environment is now being said? It is literally being said to a people before his second coming as a groom who are going to be in the exact same place of deception spiritually, and guess what they're going to end up doing? Apparently, they're going to accept a false Messiah. These are believers. And reject what? The true Messiah. How is that possible? I used to do my head in. 20 years ago, I'd be reading this. How is that? Like, what's going on here? How could you even create a world like that? Because I couldn't conceive that I was actually entertaining something in my life that was creating the very leaven being warned about. Was it possible that if I don't grow and mature and repent out of this place, that I could have been used as the very thing, or even worse, been subject to accepting something or bear well with something when another comes in their name, which Chris was reading earlier at the beginning of this. So the hope here in this, and what we're looking for in all of this, is that we have a blessed hope now coming upon the on the world, because he's opening up his truth now to us at levels which the prophets before us and the people before us, they would have just died to have access to an understanding or a revelation of this information. But all of us are going to be required to be in this place of repentance, as we spoke about with the Good Samaritan. So let us be excited about what's coming, because I don't know about you, but if we can get in a place of repentance, do you know what you start getting excited about? This was all sobering to me at first, I'll be honest with you. I'm sharing you with stuff on a journey I went through many years ago. But when I started to get out of that place where it was sobering and scary, and what's that scripture mean? What are you talking about? Or disagreeing with this person? Whatever. But when I started to actually get to a place of repentance, what do you think started to happen in my spirit? I started to get excited. I'm like, wow, you've not made this weird or confusing or difficult or anything else. What you're saying is you're finding out who loves you. What this is about, he's about to do something, the meaning of your life. You weren't just here to live some miserable existence or pursue some self-serving thing and then die. This is not what the digital simulation is for. Is whatever your life is to date, that's all it was. And every meaning and ounce you have in life, so my job, my title, my kids, my home, my money, my wealth, my riches, my whatever, gives you meaning, gives you identity. Really, it's all going. I suggest to you, if you don't have your identity in the one who's coming, you don't have a future with him. You see, we need to be in line with the one who decides what? Decides our future. You don't. You didn't even decide to be here. Who here thinks they decided to be here? It's craziness. We've bought into this thing where we're trying to create all this self-importance around our lives. And as a result, we end up entertaining things to such a degree we will not repent, because the pride in us rises up. No, I have importance. I have meaning. That thing is supposed to be, I like this, I do that, you know, da-da-da-da-da. Well, guess what? There'll be some people that will love, and this will be a sweet fragrance, this message. Others, it will be a foul odor. But I promise you this. It matters not the donkey that's delivering it. The question is the donkey delivering truth? Because guess what happens if you kill me? Does that change anything that we're reading in the Word? See, you can get rid of me. That's fine. And some of you might be planning that right now already, right? But you can do that. But that doesn't take away this. So let's just let's do this, the ultimate spiritual ad hominem. Get rid of Curtis and this all goes away. I promise you that his word is eternal. Okay? All right? And his truths are eternal. So we need to know, is Donkey Curtis relaying truth? And you don't get to be the holder of that solely. Guess what he's telling you and what environment you're supposed to be in order to contend with that? Discipleship. Let's be the very meaning of what Israel is. Jacob wrestled with Yeshua. Literally. And he was given the name Israel as a result. Let us wrestle together. Let us be this people that hunger and thirst for his truth. Let's drop our presuppositions, our baggage, all this kind of stuff. Let us help one another. Let us love one another through this. This is a big deal. This is a big deal, what's coming. There's a groom coming. I promise you that if we want to hold on to our pride and our arguments and our quarrels, and I know better, and I know this, and I know whatever else it is, on that day that it's actually happening, and the skies are ripping open and flashing from the east to the west, that this is actually happening. And guess what? All the things you think important in your life, you're about to stand in front of Yeshua HaMashiach. What a precious thing it is that we have a chance right now to think this through and to stop arguing our religious presuppositions. It doesn't matter what I believe, what you believe. What matters is what is truth. Let us continue to do this together. Amen? Let us be a people that are going to do this differently, because there's lots of weirdness out there. Okay? And if we can do that, then we're not going to get caught up with following one particular man or person or teaching or denomination or religion or whatever it is. We're not going to do that. We're going to start to grow. And it won't matter who's teaching up here. Aaron's teaching in 2 weeks' time. Shall we just take everything he says as truth? Should... So I promised I'd say Aaron. I've got somebody present here. I'm apologies, Mary. But, you know, Louis's going to be teaching next year. Is he on the holder of all truth? Yeah. All right. Yeah, we got Mark coming up. Yeah. We've got Chris is going to be doing some stuff. You know, next year we're going to be having some people that are going to start to grow. Russ is back. He's going to be sharing with us some excellent messages. You know, Adam, he's back there trying to get out of it, but he's coming up too. You know, the thing is we're going to grow and we're going to learn how to do this. Right? We're going to learn how to do this as a body. But we're going to, but you know what? I need and you need, while we do this, to be accountable as much as we can the way he's asked us to. Because guess what? Every word I utter up here is accountable to who? A serious business. I don't want what's coming. It's not what goes into a man that defiles him. It's what comes out. I don't want to keep defiling my Messiah. The only way I can do that is if we start working as a body. Can we continue to do that next year? Let's get excited about this and let's do it. He can lead us unto all truth, and we have the most exciting thing there is, and the precious blood that bought all of us, that we have a chance to experience his mercy, that we may have a chance at turning to him and to learn his righteousness, that we may fulfill the true meaning of the Melchizedek, from the order of Melchizedek, the voice of the righteous king. Amen? Okay, let's end it there. Hmm? Oh, yeah. No, duh. Sorry, this is next week. You're going to have to... I couldn't do it. I'm sorry. Okay, here we go. Hey, here's the blessing. Okay. May Yah bless you and guard you. May Yah shine his countenance upon you and be gracious to you. May Yah turn his countenance towards you and grant you shalom. Bless you, everyone. Amen. We'll have a quick Q&A and we're done.